Alright, so Black Panther has officially hit theaters, so I'm gonna talk about some spoilers from Black Panther. That is a solid spoiler warning. If you haven't seen Black Panther, you probably shouldn't watch this. And no, this video is not a play-by-play through the plot and events of Black Panther. Just gonna talk about some stuff, mostly Killmonger, but you've been warned, so let's talk spoilers. Movie starts out, it's in the early 90s, a couple of guys are dealing arms, and some Wakandans show up, and then Black Panther shows up. He shows up like Batman, just like, here. Black Panther is young King T'Chaka at that time. You find out both those guys were spies, but they were spies on each other, kind of spies, you know, because T'Chaka was like, hey, you're a spy, don't tell the other spy. The tragedy later on that I'm gonna reveal now, because spoiler talk, that was actually his brother, and when his brother whips a gun on young Forrest Whitaker, he kills him. Which family's a big thing in this movie, that just sucks. There's something about brother killing brother, I just don't like it. I mean, it makes for good tragic entertainment, but still, when you see it, I get it, I have a brother. From there though, it was a little obvious, that kid in the playground, I was like, pretty sure that's Killmonger. However, some solid setup. But then Claw becomes the main bad guy. It's a whole thing of like, Claw is selling, I almost called it adamantium vibranium. But really our introduction to Claw in this movie is also the introduction to Killmonger, where Killmonger's in that museum like, hey, what's this artifact? This lady's like, that's what that's from. Hey, what about this hammer? She's like, oh, it's from here. He's like, no, it's not. It's from Wakanda. It was stolen. And yes, it's vibranium, in which case Claw just goes clack and just like breaks the handle off. I love it when villains do that shit. They're like, oh, you don't even care about the value, like the sentimental value of it. You don't care about the history. You're gonna smelt that thing down and sell it and its weight in vibranium. True entrepreneur. But it's a very good intro. They're both ruthless. Killmonger's very intelligent. Claw's very intelligent. After they waste everyone, but that one guy's like, look, you can go, but just don't tell anybody. And the guy runs. A few steps later, he just goes, bam, kills him. Whenever a villain can do that, I'm like, oh, you're just a heinous asshole. But there is a logical reason for it, because he's like, if you do that, it spreads out the crime scene, makes it look like amateurs. I was like, all right, so there's a good reason for it. You got cat and mouse and a logical reason to do cat and mouse. Great villain moment. Then we fast forward to probably over halfway through the movie. Killmonger shows up again because he kills Claw. Just lays him down like a Christmas gift wrapped in a tarp. And the fact that he's from Wakanda, he's like, I have my right to challenge the king for the throne. That's my right. Or he's not from Wakanda, but he's Wakandan by blood. You know what I mean? And I've seen this a few times in movies before where there's someone in a leadership position and the king or someone, the situation, the tradition is someone gets to challenge the king, someone does. The king beats that person down. It's like, that's why you don't come at the king. Pretty much what happened to M'Baku early on. But Killmonger beats his ass. He straight up clubber langs him. I don't know if he clubber langs him or banes him. Probably both, because he comes in there, beats the hell out of T'Challa, throws him over a waterfall, is all right, now I'm king. And you get to see the people of Wakanda, the officers, the civilians, those who are loyal to the throne are also loyal to the person, but the throne does come first, so they're all like weeping and grieving. They're like, but you're our king now. Shit. I like that, because a lot of times in moments like that, I'm like, what would happen if the bad guy had won? It's not like Rocky or The Dark Knight Rises, in which case it's not a boxer with no political position whatsoever, and it's not a vigilante who's not a vigilante.
He's an idea.
You have this very real situation for people, where they're like, no, rebellion, and other people are like, no, not rebellion. That's treason. But because he spared M'Baku early on, he found his body, he got him, and the tribe, with all the tensions with the other tribes, are like, you guys just don't like us. Why don't you like us? This is one thing I wanted to see in the movie. It's like, why is this other tribe so completely ostracized? Like, why does nobody want them around? I mean, they don't seem bad. They don't seem like dicks. They just kind of want to be heard. I think mainly they just want to sit at the table. And that whole he has to heal arc didn't last too long. I guess we're going for what I call and what we call in astronomy, the Goldilocks zone. Not too hot, not too cold, just right. In this case, not too short, not too long, just right. Dark Knight Rises, he was healing for a little too long. With Black Panther, not healing long enough. That's what I mean when I say the second half of this movie would have been a great second movie. Because you didn't get enough time to marinate. Granted, Killmonger just, he has his plan and it's happening now. It's all happening very fast, but it's not enough time to really get the, I don't know, maybe it's because I watch a lot of Game of Thrones. I just like time for the politics to really start wrecking people. This movie didn't really give me that. It was like, all right, he's gone and he's dead. Oh, he's not dead. That was one big inconvenience. We got to stop him because he's threatening a lot of people. Could have gone for stretching that out a little longer, which really means all the stuff with Claw could have taken a backseat. I mean, for the first half of the movie, if they had cut out a lot of the outside Wakanda stuff, stayed in Wakanda, they could have fleshed out Wakanda as they actually did in the movie. It's basically what the first half had to be, but if they stayed in Wakanda, you could have had more with M'Baku, which is arguably my favorite character in the entire movie. Show some tension with him, have that draw out a little more. Maybe you find out more about why his tribe isn't allowed to hang out, but also you could have brought Killmonger in a little sooner, had a little more time under his rule. I thought Martin Freeman was toast though when the whole big throwdown's happening. It's like, all right, I gotta get into this remote control ship and start shooting down the other ships, and that one ship is shooting the glass, and it's like, all right, you better do it fast. I thought that dude was gonna die, get an honorary burial in Wakanda or something. No, he's still fine. He's alive. No one kills Watson. Nobody. But then before we know it, Black Panther's back. He's gonna face off against Killmonger, which straight up reminded me of The Dark Knight Rises.
So you came back to die with your city.
No, Dick. I came to fight you on a monorail.
And then they fight. They fight on this highly advanced monorail, which, when it's activated, negates vibranium, which I kind of found very convenient. I don't know, there was something about it that reminded me of when you're playing on the playground. When my friends and I would play on the playground, we'd be like Ninja Turtles or robots or whatever we were. And one would come at another one. He's like, ooh, I have a ray gun that would specifically nerf your thing that you were going to do. Someone else was like, ah, oh, but I have this button that specifically stops the thing that you were going to use to stop my thing. But that's what this reminded me of. It's like, did you come up with that just so you can have them fight and one of them die? I'm pretty sure. I guess I don't know enough about vibranium. I didn't know it was what, highly volatile? Is it gonna explode or something if it's not deactivated by those things? But Killmonger goes down because that deactivate the vibranium shield thing deactivates his suit. When it's coming back, he's just like, bap, stabs him with a spear. And now he dies. Really like the end though, because at the end, T'Challa's like talking to the UN. He's like, all right, we're gonna join you guys and share our tech. And they're like, what do you have to offer? And Martin Freeman's like, oh, idiots, you don't know. You didn't know a day ago, dude, calm down. So I think it's fantastic that Wakanda is going to share what they have with the rest of the world. We'll probably help out in Civil War. Now just wait for it. I'm waiting for it in Infinity War because it's only fair when you see the best in humanity, you have to see the annoying, or at least you have to show the annoying part of humanity. And that is after Thanos shows up, someone's gonna make the argument of, well, if Wakanda had shared their tech earlier, maybe we would have been ready for Thanos' invasion. It's all Wakanda's fault. That's what someone would say. But I don't only like that T'Challa spoke to the UN and was like, you know what? We're ready to show who we are. We're ready to share our tech with you. I absolutely, positively love that. This is the single most important message this movie has. Not just the movie, this is the single most important message the MCU has ever given. And that is that a solution to these such tensions is more likely to come about not from isolating yourselves or your civilization or your culture, but embracing the differences of people and sharing. We can all be different, but we can all stand together. I just thought that was a really powerful message and a powerful example that he made by taking that leap of faith. Granted, it's a leap of faith in fiction, but it's kind of like V for Vendetta said, use lies to show a truth. In this case, use fiction to show a truth. Really, if I'm gonna project my thoughts, the way I see it is we shouldn't see the Earth as necessarily countries or civilizations or continents, or really even a planet. What we are on the cosmic galactic scale of things is one house. People have their own bedrooms in this house, but really we're all under one roof. What people tend to do is go into their bedrooms, shut the door, and create a divide between them and other rooms in the house, rather than everybody coming down and mingling as a family. Sounds cheesy and optimistic, but that's just how I see it. So King T'Challa in this moment shows us kind of a roadmap of what we probably should do to get past that. Now it's what are we gonna do about it? Maybe I'm overthinking it, but that's just how it hit me. And if I could grade, rate, and review this movie based on that one scene alone, it would be awesome-tacular cube. This is fantastic. Fact is, though, it is a movie. And I review a movie as a whole, no matter how profound a moment it might have in it. So guys, in the end, I really enjoyed Black Panther. There's just some pacing issues in there. It truly is an enjoyable movie. It's a movie for everybody. And in my last video of Tales from the Comment section, I kind of implemented Stardust reactions and reacted to those. And that would be your Stardust reactions. I do want to do that with Black Panther also. So if you follow the link below to the Stardust app, download the app, follow me first, give your reaction to Black Panther, tag me at Jeremy Johns. Hopefully somewhere in there you can have something in the form of a question so I can bounce off of it. I don't know, I've never done this. But it's a new thing that enough people wanted to see me do, so I'm gonna try it, I'm gonna do it. But it also only works if enough of you do it, so there is that. It'll be fun, we all get to be in a video together. So as we'll save what you thought about Black Panther for the Stardust reactions, I will simply end with, if you like what you've seen here and you wanna see more, click right here to see more.